Hi, welcome to NewsClick. And today we are starting a show on the Central Vista. There's a proposal to redevelop the Central Vista, where a new parliament is going to come up. What is it all about? How is it going to affect the common people, the citizens? And as the government claims that it is going to reduce the carbon footprint, and it is also going to enhance the functioning of the government, we will view it from a very critical point. And we intend to run a series on it, a series of episodes describing what it is all about, how people are going to be affected, and what it means for the people of this country. So let me introduce to our panelists, our guests today, for who will actually explain what this Central Vista is all about. We have Mr. Narayan Murthy, who's an architect, and who's a known architect in India, and who was vociferously opposing this project. And also Kanchi Kohli, who is an environment researcher, who works on environmental issues and was quite active in the transit-oriented development strategy that we witnessed in Delhi, especially in Kidwai Nagar. So welcome, Narayan and Kanchi. So I think, Narayan, straight away, for a common man or a common woman staying in Delhi and different parts, because we find lots of articles have come up, and people have actually been writing on the Central Vista. But there is no huzz-buzz amongst the common people. So what is it all about? And why should it be opposed? Because we've seen a parallel drawn by the government, especially the person who got the contract, describing that, look, it's a wonderful thing that is going to happen. So how do you really place it, not just from the architectural viewpoint, but for the common people?
You know, for the last 3-4 months, we architects have been talking and thinking about it. When the proposal first hit us in September and October, it was a bolt from the blue. It was an extremely large project for the first time maybe proposed in our country. It took some amount of understanding as well. But as we got deeper into it, we began to realize some of the issues with it, which are not visible to the citizen today.
Like?
There are many of those issues, and which initially became visible to us architects among them, who are able to interpret these drawings and plans. Now, one of the things we began to look at was the fact that it seemed to be a much larger proposal than it needed to be. In terms of physical size and structure itself, that we're talking about 3 crore square feet of space built up there. The idea of making our parliament redundant, this building in which our constitution has been written, and building a new parliament to replace it, seemed a bit strong. So the initial thought started around all of that. Some of the core crucial issues when you come down to it are, one is the highly emotive issue. This is a space which this country conceives of as its iconic national space. You know, this is the space down which Mahatma Gandhi's funeral cottage went. This is the space in which the parliament stands, where our constitution was written. This is the space we know that the likes of Nehru, Gandhi, Sardar Patel, Subhash Chandra Bose drove and walked up and down. You know, momentous things in this nation's history have happened there. So it's, in that sense, a very delicate part of our emotional memory as a nation.
So emotional one, okay. What else?
The second part of it is that this space was devised as a public space. Even in the earliest conception, the crossing of Rajpath and Janpath, it earlier was called Kingsway and Queensway. And when we got independence, our founding fathers very imaginatively called it Rajpath and Janpath. And the crossing of those is the intersection of the government and the people. The Janpath connects Connaught Place, which is the space of commerce, to Humayun's tomb, to Safdarjung's tomb, I'm sorry. And Rajpath, of course, connects the presidential estate symbolically to the old fort.
Basically, urban commons. It's part of the urban commons.
And that particular crossing was recognized as a public space. Now, in 1961, when we got our first master plan of Delhi, that actually made 2/3 of the whole length of Rajpath and the whole sweep of the Prince's Palace Circle, the sea hexagon, as it's called, into socio-cultural spaces. It was meant to be for public theatres, libraries, archives, buildings of that nature. Today, this is set to take all that public space away into government offices, which will necessarily be restricted access zones.
But already there are government offices.
Only a few of them are there. If you look at the length of Rajpath, it's only less than 1/3 of it. Okay. And so that is the second thing. Now, at the moment, the space, the open space as it exists.
So, emotive one.
Socio-cultural
second,
one.
Second, you said it's socio-cultural urban, one. Urban commons.
Exactly. Yeah. Also, there is a concept of decentralization in the master plan of Delhi, which is a legal document, so to speak. It is spoken that no further government offices will come up in the heart of Delhi. Okay. If they come up, they will come up in the NCR region. So, what could be the rationale for discarding that suddenly and bringing a huge number of offices centralized into one space? That, of course, will bring many issues which probably Kanchi will touch upon better, which is to say traffic. How is it going to impact traffic? How is it going to impact pollution? The densification of the space will definitely have certain negatives in the time to follow. And this actually flies in the face of the minimum government, maximum governance principle of the government. We really were looking at downsizing of government.
It will be the inverse stuff.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. I think, Kanchi, there's an interesting thing that Narayan mentioned, and that's about the whole question of densification. Now, we have been watching those videos, especially shown by the government official. Yeah, who's got the contract? Because I've not gone into the ambiguity. I mean, because people have actually described also it's hugely, hugely ambiguous. People don't even know, which building is to come up, which is to go. But one thing that he mentions is that it is very low densification. I mean, it's 25,000. He says we can go even up to 50,000, and that reduces carbon space. And something that he mentions is that 1,000 crore is per annum that's the government going to save. You know, if the mobility happens to be through underground tunnels, that. So, how do you view all this?
See, I think first, as you yourself said, this has been spoken as an evolving project. And it's also.
I've never heard of.
You know, as we go along, we will decide whether this building should come up, this building should go down. Even in the last 4 or 5 months. You've seen the evolution of the project come up, as and when there is a
continuously evolving.
It is having. In that scenario, for a city and for a country that is trying to deal with issues of groundwater, issues of air pollution, issues of how much urban construction is eating into public space, how much whether densification should happen or not happen, how much of an area will become a dust bowl or not, a whole bunch of these issues are even difficult to tackle on factual basis, primarily because it's an evolving project. So
you never know what is going to happen.
And what we have right now is two or three kinds of discussions that have happened. We'll start with building the parliament first. So, everybody's focused on how many trees are going to be cut with respect to the parliament. Now, if you see the parliament construction and redevelopment in along with the entire central Vista, the impact zone changes.
Okay. And how if does the, it change?
For instance, most impact assessment procedures will look at a 5 kilometer or a 10 kilometer radius around the project. Okay. Now, if the project is evolving, the radius is evolving. Okay. So you need to first be very clear and disclose what the project is. And once the project is, has been spoken about, then you actually devise what the impact zone is, what is going to be the impact on groundwater, what is going to be an impact on air. In fact, it's quite ironic that this is coming at a time where the city has been raising huge concerns about tree felling, about open spaces. Every year, the government needs to actually land up banning construction activity because of air pollution. So, in the light of all these concerns being thrown up, it's a little bit of a surprise that, a large-scale redevelopment project is coming up and it's being treated as a very routine construction project.
So, okay. So, what we can figure out is it's evolving. Nobody knows what is going to happen. So, every date is evolving, okay? Probably we've never heard of such a project. There are DPRs and there's a set project, how we construct it. So it's quite ambiguous that way. And second, you also mentioned about there's no count of the trees that we're going to lose.
So even if there is a count, you first need to figure out what the project is. And with respect to that project, how many are the trees? And that also has to be read in the light of when was the last tree census in
Delhi?
So
what is this radius that you're trying to explain? Because this 5 kilometer radius, how does, what does it mean for a common person?
So basically, for any urban construction project or any project, I would say, there is a procedure for environment impact assessment. Now, environment impact assessment usually is you take a radius of about 10 kilometers. And that 10 kilometer radius is determined on what the site is. Okay. Now, if the site is smaller, your 10 kilometer radius is smaller. If the site is long, bigger, so if it's from Rashtrapati Bhavan all the way to India Gate, the site changes. If it's from Rashtrapati Bhavan to Yamuna, the radius changes. So all those kinds of things have a huge bearing on how we even understand what impact it's going to have on us.
Okay, so Narayan, I think there's another very interesting feature about the project, and that pertains to, because there is a kind of grouping even amongst the architects, because definitely a good number of architects are opposing it. But some of them actually also came for the bid. They wanted the contract. So are you per se completely against the project? Because many of the people have also mentioned about the cost. Or do you think that the way this contract has been given to a particular person, that is actually problematic? So
as one of my friends who's an architect is very fond of saying, he's also part of this effort, and he says, we architects can never be anti-development.
Okay.
Our bread and butter depends on development. Okay. So to a very great extent, no architect says per se that you cannot recognize the fact that, you know, maybe some government offices need to grow, or maybe our parliament needs some other facilities which are lacking today. The issue is that how do you, in a democracy, evolve a program like this? This in a democracy, first there should be some level of debate among parliamentarians in open society, among academics, among domain experts like environmentalists, domain experts like urban planners, to for a minute to digress and explain what we were talking about, that 10 kilometer radius. Yeah. It's as simple as the fact that if there is a traffic jam today at All India Medical Crossing, okay, the effect of that sometimes can be felt as far away as Gurgaon.
Yeah,
so that is the reason why an impact assessment is done from the perspective of traffic, from the perspective of tree count in that general area, from the perspective of how much the population is, which is going to overload, say, things like metros tomorrow. So that's the reason. So there should actually, for a project like this, have been a clear DPR, a brief, a detailed project report, as it were, across disciplines to look at the overall issue, to define, first of all, what the problems are which need to be solved through this project. And therefore, what would the correct methods of solving them be? And that is then given to the architect. The architect is only the interpreter of that brief. That brief is not set by architects. It is set by sociologists, by planners, by environmentalists, by the government, of course. So that is completely lacking in this project. So what all architects were pointing out, so even out of the bidders, as you mentioned, in September, I believe, and this is before I got aware of the project, when the first meeting, pre-bid meeting happened, there were 27 architectural firms present. 26 of them signed a request, there and then written, to the government that this should not be conducted in this manner as a tender, but should be conducted as an open design
competition. So the transparency is a major issue.
Fine. 26 people signed that, only one 27th person did not.
Who got it?
Who got it?
Kanchi, because we are really running short of time, and we'll be doing a series of episodes on it. How do you, because a section of the people, I mean, who, naturalists, bird watchers, they said if you want to reconstruct a capital, just take 50 kilometers off. I mean, why don't you move out? I mean, what is your or maybe 100 kilometers off. I mean, why do you really want to redevelop this region?
No, I think that question is not only about picking up government offices from one place and, you know, moving the injustice to another place.
Okay.
It has to be also a full detailed discussion of the social implications of even moving, you know, government out of this place. Obviously, you will be creating some government of another place. I think a much more a considered view of how much will we gain from, rebuilding, raising something fully down and rebuilding, or just renovating the entire space and managing with that, given that we have issues of heritage, we have issues of environment, we have issues of lived history, all part of that. And I think critically, this is a very important public space, which is visited from across the country.
Okay, I think that's all that we have right now. Thank you, Kanchi. Thank you, Narayan, for that. But I think in the first episode, what we are able to understand is that there are major implications. And those implications, if not addressed, then it is something which is very ambiguous, non-transparent, and is definitely going to hit the citizens of Delhi and probably of the entire country. Thank you so much. Thank you.